السلام على سيدنا ونبينا وحبيب قلوبنا أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد وعلى آل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين لا سيما بقية الله في الأرضين أرواحنا له فداء أما بعد فقد قال الله سبحانه وتعالى في كتابه الكريم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم يا أيها النبي اتق الله ولا تطع الكافرين والمنافقين إن الله كان عليما حكيما صدق الله علي العظيم
اللهم صل على محمد وعلى
السلام عليكم ورحمه الله وبركاته First I would like to say that it's alhamdulillah a pleasure to be here at the Saba Center again after about 2 years. I came here 2 years ago. Definitely see the mu'minin and mu'minat who are in this community. Since the beginning of this sacred month of Muharram, I have been speaking about a topic which is very important for us to contemplate and to understand, and that is the topic of Al-Munafiqun, the hypocrites. One of the reasons why I chose this particular topic for this sacred month of Muharram is that Imam Zain al-Abidin alayhi afdhalus salatu wassalam, when he returned back to Medina after the events of Karbala, Kufa, and Sham, as he entered into Medina, there was one statement that he made. He said that he is coming back to a place, and not only did he state this, he swore by Allah. And this is something that is very weighty, that when the Imam or the prophets, they say Wallah, because as we know, Rasulullah and also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran says, do not swear by Allah lightly. Do not make these type of statements and take them lightly. But the Imam, he swore by Allah. He says, Wallah, la yujad 20 nafar fi hadhihi al-Madina yuhibbuna ahla al-bayt. I swear by Allah, there are not even 20 people in this city who love us, who love the Ahlul Bayt. That the state of the Ummah had become so decadent that not even 20 people could be found in the city of Medina, in the city of Rasulullah, who actually recognize and knew the status of Ahlul Bayt alayhim afdhalus salatu wassalam, and love them as they should be loved. Love them as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he set as the foundation of Islam. As he set for the compensation, or as what we can consider the reimbursement for all that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given. And the Prophet, he was told this, tell his ummah this, لَا أَسْأَلُكُمْ عَلَيْهِ أَجْرًا إِلَّا مَوَدَّةَ فِي الْقُرْبَى. But where was this mawadda? Where was this love? Where was this recognition of the status of Ahlul Bayt? The Imam says, I swear, there's not even 20 people. This is one reason. Another reason why I chose this particular topic for the sacred month is that as we have passed the state of, or the date of Ashura, the 10th of Muharram, and perhaps we have participated in the A'mal of the 10th of Muharram, if you notice that in these A'mals, there are two surahs that are recommended to recite. One is Surah Al-Munafiqun that, alhamdulillah, beautifully, our brother Muhammad Ali, he recited. The other is Surah Al-Ahzab. One of the particularities of both of these surahs is that they discuss the concept or the idea of munafiqun, the hypocrites, who the hypocrites are, what are the characteristics and traits of the hypocrites. In Surah Al-Munafiqun itself, which at this point I will not go over all of that surah, I did that for the first 10 days of Muharram, and inshallah you can refer to whatever speeches have been placed online. I hear all of them haven't been placed, but the ones that are, you can refer to that. But there are about 8 or 9 characteristics and traits that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he points out in Surah Al-Munafiqun of the Munafiq. Such as, the Munafiq, he is someone who lies, who's a liar. The Munafiq is someone who is mustakbir, who is arrogant, who is fasik, who is corrupt, so forth and so on. Likewise, in Surah Al-Munafiqun, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also outlines the plots that the munafiqun, that they carry out against the believers. And these traits or these plots that, or attacks against the believers, are no other than the same attacks that many of the kuffar also, they have done against the believers. One of those, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in Surah Al-Munafiqun, is economic sanctions. As states in the Surah Al-Munafiqun, that they say, لَا تُنْفِقُوا عَلَى مَنْ عِنْدَ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ. Do not spend your wealth on those who are with Rasulullah. So economic sanctions. Or, in other words, they use their wealth in order to go against haq, to go against truth. The second type of attack that they launch against the believers, same thing, the kufar, because nifaq, to some extent, is a type of kufr, is a type of disbelief. It is in the guise of belief, but it in reality is disbelief. The second attack they launch against the believers is to marginalize them, or to exile them from whatever city or place that they are in. وَلَئِنْ رَجَعْنَا إِلَى الْمَدِينَةِ لَيُخْرِجَنَّ الْعَزُّ مِنْهَا الْعَذَلُّ. That when we return back to this city, and this is a statement of Abdullah ibn Ubay, the individual about whom Surah Al-Munafiqun was revealed. And so he made the statement that when we return back to Medina, because his plot was outside of Medina, when we return back to Medina, that those who are powerful, those who have nobility, al-azzu, at least they assume that they had dignity and power, but of course Allah says the dignity and power is with Allah, His Prophet, and the believers. But nonetheless, the munafiq, that they said that when we return back to Medina, لَيُخْرِجَنَّ الْعَزُّ مِنْهَا الْعَذَلُّ, that we will exile, or we will marginalize those who we deem to be weak, meaning the believers. So these are the types of plots and attacks on the believers that the munafiq, and essentially also the kuffar, they make against the Prophet and the believers. Surah Al-Ahzab, the second surah that's also recommended to recite in the rakats, the 2 or 4 rakats that we make on the day of Ashura, also discusses the munafiqeen and also the kuffar. The first verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he starts, he says, O Prophet of Allah, but this addressed to the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In reality, is an address to the entire Ummah, not simply Rasulullah. And this is something that collectively the commentators of the Quran, whether Sunni or Shia, they have stated, they have agreed upon to some extent, to some consensus that, and in a number of places, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he does this. He addresses the Prophet, but what is intended is the Ummah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he addresses the Prophet in this way, and addresses the Ummah, Ya ayyuhan Nabi, ittaqillah. O Prophet of Allah, have consciousness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَلَا تُتَعِ الْكَافِرِينَ وَالْمُنَافِقِينَ. And do not obey the disbeliever, the non-believer, or the munafiq, or the hypocrite. إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ عَلِيمًا حَكِيمًا. And surely Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is knowing and all-wise. This verse, when we look at it and we analyze this verse of the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is placing in the hands of the believers and the prophets a method. A method by which the believers may protect themselves from the kuffar and may protect themselves from the munafiq, the hypocrites. To protect themselves from the deception, from the tricks, from the attacks and the treacheries of those who seek to annihilate, to belittle, to marginalize, to place upon them any economic sanctions or whatever tricks that they try to do in order to put down truth. And that is first and foremost to have consciousness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to have taqwa. And taqwa, unlike it has been translated many times, and I say this and I've reiterated this in a number of speeches, but it is something that we need to truly understand. Taqwa is not simply fear of Allah, that, oh, I'm afraid of Allah. But taqwa is to have consciousness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Such a deep consciousness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that on one hand, yes, you fear to be cut off from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you fear the wrath of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but you hope in His mercy. And the best way I've seen to explain this state is the state of a little child, that when a child gets lost in a large crowd, in a mall, that this child has this state of taqwa, this state of heightened consciousness. The state of heightened consciousness is such that the child, on one hand, fears that they may never see their parents again. But on the other hand, that child is hopeful that they will see their parents. And this is why you will see the child in that state of heightened consciousness. The child is crying, at times crying profusely, because they fear that this loved one, this parent, I may never see them again. So that is the fear. But the hope of that child is that child is calling the parents, mommy, mommy, dad. This is a state of consciousness. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He's saying that if you want to protect yourself, Prophet of Allah, O Ummat of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that you have this heightened state of consciousness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But how do we gain this state of consciousness? Again, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the first verse of Surah Al-Ahzab, He explains this. First, لَا تُتِعِ الْكَافِرِينَ وَالْمُنَافِقِينَ. Do not obey those who disbelieve or those who are hypocrites. Why is this? And question may arise that if someone, or especially like the Prophet, why would Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala address the Prophet saying, do not obey the disbeliever, the non-believer, and the munafiq? Especially if the individual being addressed is the Prophet, or if we look at it as the Ummah, the Muslims, that how is it that we may fall into the obedience of the non-believer and the munafiq? It's very subtle and refining point. And that is that obedience, ita'a, is directly or intricately related to truth, or at least perception of the truth, haq. Imam Sadiq alayhi salatu wasalam, he he points to this in one of his statements to Hisham ibn Hakam, a very close student to the Imam. He says, Ya Hisham, Nasbul Haqqi li ta'atillah, wa la najata illa bi ta'ah. Said, truth, and this is truth with a capital T, or reality with a capital R. He says, this reality, or whatever reality is and truth is, he said, it is connected to the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there is no salvation except for in that obedience. So note, reality or truth or what we perceive as true is connected to obedience. And of course, obedience is our actions, that how we do it. That if we believe that there's a heaven and there's a hell, if we believe that there's a reality that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He has revealed the Qur'an, revealed the books to His prophets, and has obligated us to pray, if we take that as reality, then our actions will show this. We will pray, we will fast, we will obey what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has commanded us. Likewise, if another perception of reality is placed in front of us, then naturally we will interact with that reality. Our actions will be coinciding with that reality. For example, if I told you that many of you are probably college students, right? How many of you are college students or at least go to school? Doesn't make a difference if you're a college student or you go to high school, many of you, right? So if I told you at this particular time, and if you are someone who really is into your education, that, oh, you know, I have to be at school on time. So if I told you that, oh, you know what, right now it is, or at least if you perceive that at this particular moment, it is 10 o'clock in the morning, and you have a class going on. Would you be comfortably sitting here if you knew that you had to be in class and that you will get an F if you weren't in class? Most of you, you'll be kind of answering, oh, I can't be here because I have to be there. So if you were given this perception of reality, then naturally you're going to tend to incline towards that perception of reality. Or if I told you that, okay, if there's someone waiting outside the door, as soon as you step out this door, he's going to kick you in your knee. Most of you will sit, especially if you believe what I was saying. It was like, oh no, Sheikh is not going to lie. He's not going to tell me. And so if I painted this picture of reality for you, you're going to act to it. You're going to say, well, I should sit here and just wait for that individual to leave. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He's saying that the kuffar and the munafiq, they will paint for you a perception of reality. And because these are individuals who are Allah. Why? Because you've now believed a different perception of reality. And of course, in this day and time, we can see that there are many false perceptions of reality. The false perception of reality that, oh, there are weapons of mass destruction, so we must go and we must fight here, but we find no weapons of mass destruction. There are false perceptions of reality that, oh, well, 9 out of 11 of the terrorists are from this country, but we have to fight here. These are paintings and false perceptions of reality, that when we fall into those perceptions of reality, false perceptions of reality, then we begin to obey, or we begin to accept that, and that there's nothing wrong with it. But this takes us away from truth. It takes us away from that truth which will lead to our salvation. What leads to our salvation? Truth and obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He gives us the means. But how do we gain this perception of reality? This correct perception of reality? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He gives us a method, or He alludes to this method at the end of this verse, the end of the first verse of Surah Al-Ahzab. إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ عَلِيمًا حَكِيمًا. Knowledge and wisdom. Knowledge and wisdom. He signs this verse. In fact, this is what Allama Tabatabai, one of our great commentators, he states that in many of the verses, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He puts His signature. And what he means by this, that He puts His signature, it means Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He ends the verse with one of His names or two of His names. And it is very significant in the understanding of that verse. So here, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, have consciousness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and do not obey the kuffar, the disbeliever and the hypocrite. Do not accept their false perception of reality. Inna Allah kana aliman hakima. How do we keep ourselves from falling into that false perception of reality and maintain a state of taqwa, of consciousness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? It is through knowledge. And not only having knowledge about our situation, having knowledge about our surroundings, having knowledge about those things which are occurring around us, but also being able to apply those things. And that's what hikmah is. Knowledge, a person can have knowledge, ilm, but may not have wisdom, hikmah, to apply that knowledge. But definitely if someone has hikmah, someone is hakim, meaning that they have knowledge and they are able to apply that knowledge. To give an example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran, in various places, He uses or He sets up archetypes in the Quran. And it is up to us to learn and to understand the Quran and to be able to apply these archetypes where they apply, where they may be used. And this is the whole concept behind the famous saying of Imam Sadiq, كُلُّ يَوْمٍ عَشِرَ وَكُلُّ أَرْضٍ كَرْبَلَى. Many of us, we may have knowledge about this saying that every day is Ashura and every land is Karbala. But how do we perceive the Ashura of today? How do we perceive the Karbala of today? Many of us, perhaps a very simple or very easy application of this, when we look at Bahrain, this is Karbala. The land of Bahrain is Karbala. And for them, they are living Ashura. Especially if your name is Hassan Hussein or you are among the Shia of Ali Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That the Khalifa has no mercy to kill, to shoot, to bulldozer the masajid. So we can see, yes, that's Karbala and they're living Ashura. But sometimes, and again, this may be if we are living or we are taking sometimes the false perception and we think, that's Karbala and that's Ashura. But here and now, I don't see, it's just a knowledge for me that here where I'm sitting right now, is it Karbala? Here where I'm standing, living, breathing, working, sleeping, taking class, whatever, is it Ashura or not? How do we apply that to our lives? How do we apply that to our lives so that we are gaining the lessons from Imam Hussein? To give you another example, and this is one thing that we have to think about. This is one thing that we have to contemplate. I'm just bringing this up so that we can think about it. Many times we can think about it within our own particular context or within the context of the Muslims in general. One of the ideas or concepts and I'll just allude to this, and you can go and you can read it on your own. If you kind of Google, there's an article that was written, it was called Good Muslim, Bad Muslim. Very interesting article. That what is the perception, or at least that is painted in the media, and this is what the article is about, of who is a good Muslim and who is a bad Muslim. Yazid painted the same picture during his time. Who was good, who was bad? If you agreed with Yazid, if you stood on the side of Umar ibn Sa'd and Yazid, then he could say, oh, you are good. But if you opposed, then you were bad. And we know that even when Imam Zain al-Abidin and the caravan had reached the Sham, that the people had accepted that false perception of reality so much. So much so that when that caravan was being ushered into Sham, to Damascus, that some of the people of Damascus thought that, oh, these are individuals, they're not even Muslim. That the Khalifa, he had rose up and he had stopped a revolution of non-Muslims against the Ummah of Islam. This is what people stated. One old man, he stated this, and this brought Imam Zain al-Abidin alayhi salatu wasalam to tears. That when this old man, he was happy and cheering that the non-believers were defeated. Imam Zain al-Abidin, he actually says, haven't you heard about the Mawadda of Dhul Qurba in the Quran? Haven't you heard this verse, that verse? And this old man said, yes. He says, that we are the family of Rasulullah. We are the Dhul Qurba. But the false perception of reality had been accepted by those individuals. Just to give you another example, how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, again, He gives us archetypes in the Qur'an. He gives us knowledge in the Qur'an. But it is up to us to apply this so that we will have wisdom, not simply knowledge about what's going on. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He states in the Qur'an, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, الأعراب أشد كفرا ونفاقا وأجدر أن لا يعلموا حدود ما أنزل الله على رسوله والله عليم حكيم. In Surah Al-Tawbah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, the A'rab. Al-A'rab in Arabic means the Bedouin Arabs. So the Bedouin Arabs are أشد كفرا ونفاقا. That they are the most disbelieving and hypocritical. And they are more apt not to know, or more apt to be ignorant of the laws that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or the boundaries that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has revealed to His Prophet. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is knowing, He is wise. So one question arises, that is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is He biased against the Arab? That He would say that the Bedouins, that they are the most disbelieving and the most hypocritical? Is this the case? No. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He's setting up an archetype. That if you look at the Bedouin Arabs before the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that he brought to them this message of Islam, this final message. If you look at their system, their value system, then anyone who holds that value system, then they are more apt to disbelieve and to be hypocritical. And they're more apt to be ignorant or not wanting to know what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has revealed to His Prophet. Not simply that this person, because he is Arab, no, they're many other Bedouin Arab who they themselves, they, you could say that they lived outside the box, that they did not accept those values of the pre-Islamic Arab Bedouins. For example, there's always an example given of Hatma Atai. Hatim is very well known, just pre-Islamic individual, but he had very good manners and ethics. He was someone who would go out the way to help another individual. Another individual among the Bedouin Arabs, and this is, you can find it in the Jahiliya poetry, Antar, that he was an individual, of course, he had his own little faults here and there, but nonetheless, that he always went out of his way to help others. He went out of his way to help others. So whoever has that value system, then that individual is, you know, who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that he's more prone to disbelief and hypocrisy. What is this value system, you might ask? The Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and it's important to learn this because, again, that having this value system, the Prophet, what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, is that it is leading to kufr, to disbelief, and to hypocrisy. And one reason why we recite Surah Al-Munafiqun and Surah Al-Ahzab is so that we may protect ourselves from these traits and these characteristics. So what the Prophet, he says, مَنْ كَانَ فِي قَلْبِهِ حَبَّةٌ مِّنْ خَرْدَلٍ مِّنْ عَصَبِيَّةٍ بَعَثَهُ اللَّهُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ مَعَ أَعْرَابِ الْجَاهِلِيَّةِ. He says, whosoever has the minutest amount of asabiyya. And asabiyya is, you could say, prejudice. Whoever has just a small amount of prejudice in his heart, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will raise that individual on Yawm al-Qiyamah with the A'rab al-Jahiliyyah, with the ignorant Bedouin Arabs. In other words, anyone who has that value system. Anyone who has that value system of prejudice. Why? Because this is something from Jahiliyyah. This is something that Rasulullah, he came to remove. The first being, or at least that we know from the Quran, that had this asabiyyah, this prejudice, was shaitan. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asks, is a shaitan bow to, or anyone who's in this angelic realm, bow to Adam? Shaitan says, no, I was made of fire, he's made of clay. Why should I bow? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala exiled him from that angelic realm. So Rasulullah says that this asabiyya will instill, or it will lead to kufr. It will lead to nifaq. Because once an individual has that asabiyya, then he's not looking towards what is right and what is wrong. He or she is looking at, oh, well, this individual is from my tribe, from my family, from my country, from my language, from whatever you base that asabiyya upon, then that trumps justice. That trumps justice. And when justice, and I understand that justice in Arabic is also what? Haqq. Truth, reality. La'adl is haqq. And haqq is adl. So when that truth and justice is trumped by something else, especially like this, asabiyya, then it leads to kufr, it leads to nifaq, it leads to hypocrisy. In another hadith, the Prophet, he states, al-ghadab, anger. And again, this is unfounded anger. That it also, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he will raise a person among the A'rab al-Jahiliyyah. In another very long hadith, the Prophet, he states that whenever you come across an enemy of the believers, the Prophet Allah, he says, offer him three things. And if he accepts, then you accept that from him. Now, I'll only mention two of these things because it's, in this long hadith, is covering the point that I want to make. First, he says, you come across the enemy of the believers, he says, call him towards Islam. Udu'uhu ila al-Islam. Invite him towards Islam. If he accepts, then fine, you accept that from him. He says, Then call him towards hijrah. Udu'uhu ilal hijrah ba'd al-Islam. After he accepts Islam, call him towards hijrah. And of course, from the apparent hadith, it seems that this is when the Prophet, he is about to make a hijrah, or they have already made the first stages of hijrah. So invite him to make hijrah. He says, and if he accepts, then you accept that from him. He says, but if he rejects to make hijrah, then the Prophet says, kana bimanzilati a'rabil mu'mineen. That this individual who accepts Islam, then he rejects to make hijrah with Rasulullah and the believers at that time, he is among the A'rab, the Bedouins. Not meaning that this individual is a Bedouin, but he is like, bimanzil, on the station, equal to al-A'rab, al-Mu'mineen. That while he has some sort of iman, some sort of belief, but that belief at this point is now in danger. It is in danger, one, because he's disbelieved, or he has refused to accept the hijrah. He has refused to take himself out of that danger which the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he perceived in Mecca at that time. And to take himself out of that danger, he or she would have had to make hijrah. So if they did not take themselves out of that danger, then they are like A'rabul Mu'mineen. Meaning that their belief is in danger. And this is a state that we see that many of the believers, or many of the individuals in the Ummah, they were in during the time of Imam Hussein. This is the state that a vast majority of the Ummah was in as Imam Zain al-Abidin alayhi afsalatu wasalam, he returned to Medina. And throughout the life of Imam Zain al-Abidin in Medina, in order to bring yourself out of that state, based on the advice of Imam Baqir, who was also a young boy in Karbala. Now, I'll end with this last advice from him, because this, we must take practical advice from the Imams and understand that in order so that we may be on the path of Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad, especially in this month of Muharram. This is our objective. If we haven't learned anything, then we must question that, why are we here? Where did we come from? If we came to realize our Ashura, our Karbala, our struggle, now, today, here, then we must take these jewels, these lessons from the Ahlul Bayt. Imam Baqir alayhi afsalatu wasalam, he said, Allahumma salli Muhammad wa Muhammad. He says, tafaqqahu fil halali wal haram wa illa antum a'rab. Subhanallah. تَفَقَّهُ فِي الْحَلَالِ وَالْحَرَامِ. To contemplate, to study, to learn what is halal and what is haram. Otherwise, you're A'rab. Otherwise, your iman is in danger. Otherwise, you're in danger of being like the people of Kufa. They may have had knowledge of, oh, who is Hussein ibn Ali? They didn't know that he was the son of Amir al-Mu'mineen. Amir al-Mu'mineen, he was the Khalifa, and his capital was Kufa. But they did not apply what they knew. And this is also why the Imam, he didn't say ta'allamu al-halali wal-haram. He didn't say just learn. He says tafaqqahu fil-halali wal-haram. Tafaqqahu means to learn thoroughly so that you may apply it and you may practice it. Not only so that you may learn it and you may practice it, so that those who may not be basing their actions on halal and haram, basing their actions on what the Quran states and what Rasulullah states in the Sirat of Ahlul Bayt, that you will not be fooled by their actions. Faqqahu. God forbid that one reaches the state of the people of Ahl Sham. That at least in Kufa they knew to some extent that who the Ahl Bayt were. But in Sham, a majority of the people do not know who the Ahl Bayt were. And then the state of Medina, as Imam Zain al-Abidin, he states that there's not even 20 people, not even a handful of people who know who the Ahl Bayt, who love the Ahl Bayt as they should love Ahl Bayt. Meaning that a vast majority of the people in Medina itself did not know Ahl Bayt. Because when you don't have that love for Ahl Bayt, as Allah says, he said, La as'alukum alayhi ajran illa mawaddata fil qurba. That means they don't know the Ahl Bayt. Those individuals too, they should have been in Sham, in Damascus, when Imam Zain al-Abidin alayhi afsalatu wasalam, that he began his khutbah. That when he stood in the court of Yazid, stating to the people, stating to these very people who thought that the caravan that had been ushered into Damascus was a caravan of non-believers, when they had disbelief in their hearts, that they were deceived by the Munafiqeen, that Imam Zain al-Abidin alayhi afsalatu wasalam, he raised his voice, saying, Ya ma'ashar an-nas, faman arafani, faqad arafani. O people of Sham, those of you who know me, then you know me. وَمَنْ لَمْ يَعْرِفْنِي فَأَنَا أُعْرِفَهُ نَفْسِي. And those of you who do not know me, then let me tell you who I am. Let me explain to you who I am. أَنَا بَنُو مَكَّةِ وَمِنَا. I'm the son of Mecca and Mina. أَنَا بَنُو مَكَّةِ وَمِنَا. أَنَا بَنُو مَرْوَةِ وَالصَّفَا. I am the son of Marwa and Safa, meaning that I am the one who is the offspring of Muhammad. I am the one who has founded this land. Ana banu Muhammadin al-Mustafa. I am the grandson of Muhammad al-Mustafa. Ana banu Aliyyan al-Murtada. I am the son of Ali al-Murtada. Ana banu Fatima al-Zahra. I am the son of Fatima al-Zahra, this lady who has been smashed between the door and the wall. Ana banu Fatima al-Zahra. Ana banu Khadija al-Kubra. I am the grandson of Khadija al-Kubra. Ana al-Maqtul Dhulma. I am the son of he who has been killed, who has been oppressed on the plains of Karbala. Ana ibn al-majzoon al-ra's min al-faqam. I am the son of the he whose head has been severed from his body and his head has been raised upon the Syria. Ana ibn al-atshan hatta qada. I am the son of he who was left thirsty on the plains of Karbala. He who was left thirsty and he died in the state of thirst. Ana banu sari'i Karbala. I am the son of he who has fell upon the plains of Karbala. Yo, mourners of Hussein, oh mourners of Ali ibn Hussein, that imagine that Ali ibn Hussein on the plains of Karbala, it is said that he was in a state of illness. His state was that he could not even fight and go out onto the plains of Karbala to help his father when he heard his father call out, Hal min nasirin yansuruna, wa hal min mughithin yughithuna. That his state, he was so ill that he could not go out and to help. But look how Imam Zain al-Abidin, that he was taken from this world, that Ibn al-Walid, that he poisoned this Imam, that imagine a body that is already frail from sickness, on top of being frail from sickness, as it stated that Imam Zain al-Abidin, that his whole life that he was in a state of illness, as some has narrated. But even upon the sickness, that he was poisoned to make him even more sick, that imagine that a body that is weak from sickness, that how it will feel, that once the poison is running through his body, that what pain did our Imam go through in his last days, the pain from his own sickness, and now a pain of poison running through his body. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. وسيعلم الذين ظلموا أي منقلب ينقلبون. اللهم بحق هذه المجلس العلوية اغفر ذنوبنا واستر عيوبنا وقضي حوائجنا واشف مرضانا وارحم أمواتنا وعجل فرج مولانا صاحب العصر والزمان وجعلنا من أعوانه وأنصاره والمستشهدين بين يديه وتحت لوائه بحق محمد وعلى بيته الطيبين الطاهرين.